Vijay Lakhani, an excellent communicator of Hinduism in Britain and director of the Hindu Academy, the Vivekananda Centre in London. Over the last 15 years, Sri Lakhani has given talks on Hinduism to thousands of youngsters at English schools, colleges, and universities. If you wish to get a glimpse of the modern, dynamic face of Hinduism, then do not miss this series of talks.
Shanti Vishve Deva, Shanti Brahma, Shanti Sarvam, Shanti Shanti Reva, Shanti Sama, Shanti Redi, Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
There was a man, a very rich man, he had a factory, who knows? Churning out a lot of material, very well to do, lived in a beautiful house, large house, had married to a very beautiful lady who looked like Aishwarya Rai, and things were working out very well for him. His son, who looked like Hrithik Roshan, was daddy. And you know, had a Rolls Royce, and things were working very well, factory, business, everything going extremely well. And then one morning he got up, and there was credit crunch. And the bank phoned up saying, we looked at your accounts, but I think we can't fund you anymore. So from tomorrow, administrator will go to your factory and take over your factory. You don't need to go to your factory anymore. It doesn't belong to you anymore. I said, my factory gone? My business gone? Oh, by the way, the house is also mortgaged, so the house goes as well. I said, my house will go as well. You're feeling distressed first thing in the morning. He goes down to the kitchen. Normally, wife makes nice breakfast for him. Oh, my darling, here. Today, no wife. Just a note. The milkman looked more kind of beautiful, handsome than you, so I ran away with the milkman. She's run away with the milkman. This is getting out of control. This is too much. You're getting distressed, and the son comes drunk, dead. I had an accident with your Rolls Royce, and I'm drunk, so they're going to arrest me and put me in prison. My son gone, my wife gone, my business gone, and the man is really distressed. So he sits in the corner in his room and he phones his best friend. He says, my friend, come. He's shaking and shivering and crying. The friend said, okay, I'll come. The best friend, hopefully they'll come. As soon as he entered his room, he said, can you see that slipper in the corner? The friend said, yes. Can you pick it up? He said, yes. What does he want, a slipper? Come here, he told the friend. Hit me on the head with the slipper. He said, why should I hit you on the, because I deserve it, he said. Everything is going wrong for me. My wife has run away, my business disappeared, my son is in trouble. So you're my best friend, hit me with a slipper now. That's the only thing left out. So why didn't you finish the job? I deserve it because I must have done bad karma in my past life. So I deserve to be beaten up. Now you see, this is the worst scenario of law of karma, worst understanding of law of karma. Law of karma never told you, you become a fatalist, means accept, oh, I deserve it. Nobody deserves it. When things gang up against you, you roll up, law of karma says, roll up your sleeves and say, okay, let's fight this situation. So you go to another bank, start another business, marry somebody more beautiful than Aishwarya Rai? That lady is laughing. She thinks it's a good idea. So we can smile with each other. She's my sister. So anyway, so get the most beautiful girl and marry again. Start again and roll up your sleeves and come fighting. That's what law of karma teaches. Not to become a fatalist. Or don't blame somebody if something miss, some disaster falls on somebody. Never say he deserves it because of law of karma. A lot of things have ganged up, and the poor man may have no contribution towards it, and he's paying a price for it. This is one part of law of karma that the Hindus have forgotten. And when you see, this is why, you notice this, in the Indian subcontinent, you see somebody disabled, people will make fun of him. In this country, you try and make fun of him, you are in real trouble. See, they have recognized human dignity. Don't blame somebody. You know, Glenn Hoddle was saying this to a disabled, he deserves it. He lost his job as a captain, England captain. So be careful. Understand the law of karma in its full maturity. That's one part of the equation. The second part of the equation. You see, just as you can become fatalist about your condition, say, I deserve it, you don't deserve it, stand up and fight. Sort yourself out. The other part where the Hindus have failed miserably because they have not understood the law of karma in its maturity, It's not only what you set into motion that's going to catch up with you. That's a positive idea of law of karma. What you fail to do, suppose you see an issue in front of your eyes that needs to be addressed, and you fail to address it, and you turn your back, that is also bad karma. You forget that part of the equation. If you see an issue in front of your eyes that needs to be addressed, like Vinaya Ben finds that you chaps should learn Hinduism, so she's not turning her back. She said, Jabai, come, teach. So don't turn your back. When you see a situation in front of your eyes, you don't turn your back. That is bad karma. Why am I saying this? Look, I'm telling you, making all of you shudder. So be it. If you go to India today, and you see the first thing that will hit you, especially the children, will hit them, is the big difference between people with a lot of money and people with no money. First thing, you go in the house, your friend's house, the servants, they are in rags. And whatever leftover food, they sit on the corner and on the floor and eat it. You can't do that in London. And they sit and say, oh, this is terrible. So why this big difference between have and have nots? Again, I'm waving my finger at the Hindus, not understanding the law of karma. When you see an issue in front of your eyes, somebody is struggling, there's no food, there's no clothing, and you turn your way, haha, they deserve it, law of karma. This is the most horrible thing to say. When you see a situation in front of you that needs to be addressed, you stand up and address it. That is the positive thing about law of karma. Don't turn your back on it. See, this is the important part. The Hindus, look, that's why modern India, you have this big difference between a lot of money and no money. They allow it. Why do they allow it? Because the rich people say, oh, well, these people deserve it. They must learn bad things in their past life, law of karma, catching up with them, let them starve. What a horrible thing to say. See, misunderstanding, that is why it's necessary for me to present a contemporary vision of religion, Hinduism, that is suited to the world that we live in. So we must address an issue that's wrong, we must say, this is wrong. Like when I said Abrahamic tradition saying, sending you to hell, that's wrong. I'm saying Hindu tradition saying, you deserve it, that's wrong. Must stand up again. No way. Nobody deserves to be in that difficult. In fact, your responsibility to sort them out, not turn your back. And I'll give one classic example that you may like to hear. This is something that comes out of the stories of Hindu tradition. There's a story in the Mahabharata where Bhishma Pita, a great superhero of the Hindu tradition, that Bhishma Pita is now in the battlefield and his whole body is completely, you know, covered with arrows. He's lying on a bed of arrows, dying. And then, of course, you know, this is a dialogue. Be careful, this is a dialogue. I don't think this happened actually, but dialogue. And Krishna Menon said, you are a great hero, a wonderful gentleman. Why are you in this position? And Bhishma gave that answer, which is necessary for modern India to recognize. He said, when these Kauravas were mistreating the Pandavas, I turned my back. And now I'm paying a price for it. See? Not understanding the law of karma in its full maturity. And modern India needs to relearn this lesson. So when you see a big difference between have and have not, the way your karma should be to sort it out. And this nation has done it. Haven't you seen? This nation has done it. They brought this egalitarian system. No big haves and have nots. Oh yeah, people have more money, people less, but they're all okay. Not in like India, there's a huge gap. They're starving. And you say, oh, it's okay, law of karma. So I needed to tidy up and give you this contemporary vision of law of karma. It gives a deeper vision about what religion should be like, or Hinduism, dharma should be like. That's one aspect. See, the first discovery of the Hindu, the ancient Indian man, was to discover things are connected by cause and effect. If you understand it in its maturity, it's a very powerful thing, because all science are nothing but law of cause and effect. So it's as central as any science, the idea of law of karma. And yet, because we don't understand it, we have turned it into something very nasty and negative, becoming fatalistic on our own conditioning, I deserve it, or being kind of indifferent to the suffering of others, saying, oh, they deserve it, oh, they don't deserve it. Get sorted out. So if you like, this is the contemporary vision that I'm promoting. Why? So that the Hindus will stir up and wake up. They are still lying, you know, apart from Modi, the rest are really, you've heard the story, they'll leave it alone. So this is important to present. This second idea that became visible in the Dharmic tradition. This is, so the law of karma is central for all the four Dharmic tradition. And the second thing they became visible, they discovered, is this idea that we are born again and again. How do they know this? You see, again, very interesting thing. The Indic tradition, all the four Indian traditions say, we are born again and again and again. The reincarnation. In Buddhism, I call it rebirth. So this idea that we are born again and again is a central feature of the four Indian dharmic traditions. Now you may say, but Mr. Lakhani, he sounds like a nice colorful thing, but I don't remember my past life. And can I ask you here, anybody here remember their past lives? See, blank. This is very worrying. Maybe the whole thing is made up. Just to give you comfort, somebody died, don't worry, he'll be reborn. Maybe just comfort. Maybe it's not true. How do we know we are reborn? Or again, born again and again? I don't remember any of my past lives. The reason is this. From one life to another life, when you die and you go into the next life, the transition is very jagged, very, very difficult, very traumatic. So the memory just gets wiped out. So it gets wiped out. But that's not proof of reincarnation. I'll let you do the research for yourself. A lot of proper research has been done on the theory of reincarnation by University of Virginia. They discovered about 3,000 children, normally about 39 months old, who could recall their past life spontaneously. They're not Hindus. They could be English, German, Jews, atheists, theists, Christian, Muslim, all right. Children suddenly talk about a different life. They say, I'm not here, I'm not David, I'm John. And mommy will smack him, say, you're David. No, I'm John. And the boy will start talking about another life. He says, mommy, by the way, I'm married. You're a three-year-old, you're married. And I've got three children. You're three children? Oh, yes. And he gives the name of the children. He gives the name of the street where he lives, the name of his wife, the name of his children. He gives all this information. The little chap starts babbling. Now, this is just babbling. But then, this professor who spent 40 years of his life researching, he would go and check him out, ask 100 questions about his past life. And this is the funny part, or the interesting part. In many cases, it's possible to check if what this guy is this little chap is talking about is true or not. Because he'll say, I lived 50 years ago in a village next door, and he talks about all the blah, blah, blah. And they can check it out. You've got birth record, death record, marriage record. So this Professor Stevenson goes and checks it out. And it fits. So he's telling the community, science community, you tell me why they are linked. How these two lives are connected? You tell me. They say, Mr. must be genetic link. There's no genetic link. There's no uncle, aunt, nothing. So genes are not passing the information. How are they linked? Every excuse you find to try and answer it fails. So Stevenson says, the only proof, only theory that fits the facts that I've discovered, 3,000 children, is the theory of reincarnation. So it's not just a woolly thing, waffly thing. It's a very serious thing the ancient Indians discovered, become part of the four dharmic tradition, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Sikhism. They subscribe to it. I would say half the world population believe in reincarnation. In the United Kingdom, when they did research, BBC did some research a few years back, about 30% of the youngsters in this country believe in reincarnation. Even some Christian minister in the USA, they found in Newsweek magazine, believe in reincarnation. They're not supposed to. They're supposed to go to heaven or hell. But they believe in reincarnation. So it's not an idea that's outdated. It's not a woolly idea. There's solid research behind it. And why is it so important? The reason are two reasons. First thing is this. All the activity you set into, suppose you were trying to learn music, or suppose you were trying to learn math, so you're mastering math, so you're at Oxford University, oh, I'm so clever. And suppose for some reason, accident to die. All your effort wasted? No, no, no. Theory of reincarnation is a very lovely thing. You say, no, nothing is lost. The character, the mental state you developed, your mental discipline you developed, will stay with you as your character come to you in the next life. You say, huh? Let me do a story. Again, you look so serious. Chaps, come on, lighten up. Do a story. There was a kingdom ruled by a madcap king, nutty king, but we always have them. We might have one in the United States, the way things are going. So this is ruled by a nutty guy. And the problem with this nutty guy was, nutty king was, he would invite anybody from his kingdom, say, come and visit me in the palace. And if that man goes, he just kills him. Just chops his head off. This is a terrible fellow. Don't like him. So everybody in this town, they love to stay in the city, but then this guy has got his habit of inviting them. So everybody shudders. So one day, very pious man, very nice, gentle person, looking after his family, living a nice life, got a knock on his door. He opened the door, the king's men were there. The king has invited you to come to the palace, said the guards. Yeah, you can imagine, his heart must be beating and he must be going, this is terrible news. So he started shaking. I don't blame him, he started shaking. He said, now, let me go to my best friend and see if he can help me. So he went to his best friend, Of course, the best friend should help him out when he's shaking like this. Went to the best friend and said, why are you shaking? He said, look, the king is invited. You know what happened to me now. Please help me. The best friend said, well, bad luck. And shut the door in his face. Now, we hope we don't get friends like that. Shut the door in his face.
They're not best anyway.
They're not best, but he thought they were the best. So he said, this is terrible. Let me go to my second best friend. Perhaps he will support me, help me. He knocked on the door. The second best friend said, yeah, well, why are you shaking? The king has invited me, the mad king. What will happen to me now? That's why I'm shaking. The second one said, very bad news. But as you are shaking, I'll hold your hand so you stop shaking, and I'll take you to the palace gates. And then I'll come back. I won't come in. You know the king. I'll come up to the, just hold your shaky hand and take you to the palace gates and then say goodbye, bye-bye, wish you well. That's all I can do. He said, that's all you can do? This is terrible. He's not helping me either. So he was really despondent. He said, what to do? Then while he was walking, he met a casual friend, a person who just meets casually, you know, not your best friend, you know, people you kind of go out for dinner, etc. And this casual friend said, why are you shaking? He said, I can't tell you. The king has invited me. I'm in trouble. The casual man said, don't worry. Look at the language. Don't worry. I will go ahead of you and plead on your behalf. He said, you plead on my behalf? Oh, yes. I will go ahead of you. Before you go in the palace, I will go before you and tell the king what a lovely chap you are. I'll plead on your behalf. He said, you are a good chap here. Now, this is just a funny part of a very important story. The story is this, that mad king is the king of death. We are all going to face it. Without reason, rhyme, because zoom, your life is chopped off. We see it in our family relations. We say, what happened to my friend? You know, he's mad king. Death is like that, just comes and knocks you out. So when things are bad, we're suffering with a serious illness, we think, who can we turn to? And he says, money, bank balance, yes. And if he's in cash in India, no good now.
Isn't it
500 rupees, 1,000 rupees, no good now. But the thing is, it's my money, my bank account. So when you are struggling, you go to your bank account, say, can you transfer it when I'm born again or somewhere? Can I take it with me? The bank says, close the door in your face, go away. Can't do that. Full stop, out. So the best friend, the one for whom you lived all your life, in fact, all of you, the adults, I'm telling you, think carefully. All our lives are really focused on this idea, money, property, possession. We want that, all of us. And the Gujaratis are worse. And I'm telling you truthfully, I told you I can criticize myself. Gujaratis are worse. Even an old man about to die, I'm dying, dikara bajunukar sastu che leile. He's dying, he's buy the house next door is cheap. This is, leave it alone now, go away. But you see, we are stuck with money. We think this is our best friend. All our lives are spent hanging on to what we think is our best friend. And that doesn't help you one bit. The second best friend in the story is our family and friends. We love them. All our life, will you analyze? First you look for money. Then you say, my family, my friends, all my social circle is so lovely. I love all these guys. When time comes to go, you tell them, sort me out. They come to the cremation ground and say goodbye. They can't come with you, lost. So who is the casual friend you thought will not help is going ahead of you? That casual friend, my friends, is the character you develop for yourself. Your character stays with you. It goes ahead of you and prepares your next life. The character, suppose you are a very focused individual. That focusing ability that you have, suppose you love music and you kind of mastered it, that will stay with you. So the effort you put in this life is not lost. That is your asset that comes with you from one life to another life. The character. So character must be the only thing you should focus on, not money. The character I develop is very upright, very straightforward. I love this kind of very upright mannerism. That will be my asset that I take from one life to another life. So the character that you develop is the best thing that you must do, not properly possession, friends, family. The character you develop for yourself is the only thing that comes from one life to another life. This is one of the greatest things that comes out of the theory of reincarnation. You get measured reward for the measured work you put in. Suppose you put in so much work in music or art or mathematics, that much effort you put in becomes your character. In your next life, when you see some children, they are very good in math, so tabla straight away, as soon as they are born, they go ding, 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 they start playing. You know, where did he learn this from? Past life. And you see Mozart composing opera at the age of 7. How do you compose opera at the age of 7? Oh, you have some genetic mutation. That's no genetic piece background. This guy was a musician for many lifetimes, so it comes naturally in the next life. So the work you put in is not lost because of reincarnation. You continue your journey where you left off. See the beautiful part? Measured reward for the measured work you put in. This is the beauty of reincarnation, not only one. There's a second aspect that is very important. Why am I mentioning this? It's important that we talk about it very honestly. I told you I'm giving you contemporary Hinduism, modern Hinduism, which will tackle the issues that we face in the world that we live in. When you have a situation where your infinite reward for finite work you put, suppose you put only this much work, you get infinite reward. See, this is ridiculous. You can't get infinite reward. For the amount of work you put in, you must get that much reward, not more. If you promise that to anybody, they become fanatic. You understand what I'm saying? Do you know why people blow themselves up? Because they say, this life is only a little thing to pay. This life I've lost 50 years, 100 years, life, I'll lose it. Because I'm going to get infinite reward. This is why you get fanatic behavior. Reincarnation has to come back into fashion. Let me again tell you. Reincarnation is a new idea. Whole of the Western world believed in reincarnation. Like all the Greek philosophers, Aristotle, Plato, Socrates, Python, they all believe in reincarnation. So it was a very important idea in the Western civilization. But then somehow they decided, okay, let's do a carrot and stick argument. Either you go to heaven or you go to hell, so you behave well. Become a good, devout Christian. They decided to bring it in. It was literally done in a council of, you know, cardinals. They sat down and said, now, should we keep on reincarnation? Let it go. Just let it go. So it was already in the Western civilization. They let it go. And it's creating fanatics of blowing themselves up. So the modern vision of Hinduism saying, kind of visit the idea of reincarnation because it will solve the problem of terrorism, of people blowing themselves up. Because reincarnation, you are not going to heaven. You come back again. You're not sorted yourself out. It's a very cutting comment to pass. I don't mind passing it. It's very risky for me, but I talk like this. I told you I'm going to give you contemporary Hinduism that is suited to the world that we live in. And the world requires this kind of knowledge. So reincarnation is not something that you can forget. It needs to be revisited. It needs to be reinvigorated. And there are a lot of other things that come out of reincarnation. I just touch on some of them. So reincarnation is very central. Now, the Sanskrit term you use to explain the word reincarnation is called samsara. Be careful, it's not samskar, it is samsara. Samsara means continuity of existence. This is what it means in Sanskrit, continuity of existence. So, believe reincarnation is samsara, means continuity of life and death. You continue the cycle. You say, Mr. Lakhani, suppose you have to do it again and again, surely it's getting like a prison. This is terrible. An example we give is very interesting. We say, he's like a child who likes to go on the merry-go-round. And you take him to the fun fair, he says, Dad, I want to go on the merry-go-round. It's okay, how many times do you want to go around? Oh, give me 5 tickets. 5? Yes, 5, I love it. So you buy him 5 tickets, and he goes on the merry-go-round. He goes around once, he goes, yahoo! Children do that. Second time he goes around, he doesn't go, yahoo! He goes, yahoo! He's getting tired. Third time he goes around, he goes, okay. Fourth time it goes round, he says, I'm feeling dizzy. Fifth time it goes round, he said, Dad, I'm going to puke. Take me off. So the child said, enough merry-go-round. I had enough. I want to get off. In the same way, when we are born again and again and again, you think it's so fun to be born again and, you know, do this and that and enjoy life and all that and marry that handsome boy or marry that beautiful girl. We like to be born again and again, surely. But at some stage, you become tired of it. It's enough is enough. And where does it come from? Not from somebody waving your fingers, oh, you must get tired of your, you know, reincarnation. No, it comes from you. You say enough, enough. Like, you know, remember the story in Matilda? That boy was made to force to eat a chocolate cake, a big chocolate. We love chocolate, but he was given a big cake. He said, eat it now. And he was struggling. He was puking. In the same way, when you begin to say, reincarnation, enough, I had enough chocolate cake, I don't want to have any more. When you say it from within you, time has come for you to become mature and get over reincarnation. And this is a very important thing that happens individually. It doesn't come because you go to a class and it's okay, now you must look for end of reincarnation. No, it comes from you. And when the stirring up comes from within you, saying, what is this? What is this? I'm getting tired of this. born again, again, nappies, they smack you on the bottom, and you do wee wee, and they make you teach the alphabet again. It's tiring, enough is enough. This boy is laughing, no more alphabets. So when that maturity comes within you, reincarnation will come to a halt. How does it come to a halt? You try and make sense of who am I? Why am I coming up, coming and going? What is going on? You look deep within. When you dive deep within, you realize that you are something so grand and great that you don't need to be born to eat chocolate cakes anymore. They don't attract you anymore. And when that happens, the Sanskrit term is moksha. Moksha means mokshaya, end of delusion. That I need to eat chocolate cake, I get my fun from chocolate cake. It's enough. That's called, don't write in the exam, moksha means no chocolate cake. Be careful. But end of delusion regarding who we are, what is this all about? And when that arises from within you, you finish your cycle of reincarnation, you attain moksha. So today I just started by using the word, clarifying the word dharma, the word sanatan, the word Hindu, the word samsara and moksha, as well as the most important thing, the law of karma, law of cause and effect in personal terms. Majority of Hindus have no clue about it. They hear these words and they say, oh, I don't know, but I'm going to touch on it straight away. You see, the tradition, dharmic tradition, is trying to make sense of the world that we live in. What is this? What is this? Who am I? What am I doing here? I didn't ask to be born. Why am I here? What's going on? This is the journey of dharma. So how did it finish? I'm going to finish it now. Because we had the luxury in the West, they had to fight nature external, cold weather, ice age, and literally surviving was very difficult. They had to look outside. How do we survive in the caves? What do we wear? They were fighting nature external. Their whole attention was nature external. We had the luxury. I told you the Indian subcontinent is so fertile, so warm. We had the luxury of looking inwards. Look, I'm not saying we are clever. I'm saying we had luxury. We needed to fight nature external, so we looked inward. And how did this journey begin? We said, before we make sense of the world outside, how things operate, English law of karma and all that, what are my faculties? What is my credential? Don't you understand? Suppose, this is a very important thing to understand. In order for you to understand the world outside, first you must know what is my capacity to understand. What capacity do I have? What is my credibility? Who am I? And this is very important. That is how, before you make sense of the world outside, you must know what is my limitation. Suppose you are a dabu, word. Then your understanding will vary like a dabu. But if you are a very sharp cookie, you can dig deeper into nature of reality. So let us sort ourselves out. So the journey went inward. We had the luxury of looking inward. Before that, the dharmic tradition was materialistic. Just think about atoms. We were thinking about atoms long time ago. Things made of atoms, everything, anu and paramanu. But then the journey went inward, and that's where we hit the jackpot, the grandest prize of humanity. We hit it. How did we hit it? We say, let us make sense of ourselves. Who are we? What is our true nature? Let's look inward. And one particular sage, I don't know whether a historic figure or made-up figure, who really hit the jackpot is a sage called Kapil. Kapil. The first person to succeed in looking inward and say, what is my true nature, is this ancient sage called Kapil. The whole of humanity must pay tribute. The first time humanity discovered something great and grand about what is our nature. And the first person to discover it is Kapil. What did he do? He closed his eyes. He had the luxury to look inward. Who am I? Who am I? Okay, we start with the body. I need food. I need to cover it. Okay, that's my body. Okay. Oh, then I've got a mind which is vacillating, giving different words and thoughts appearing all the time. I can't stop it even. It's going woo like that all the time. And he said, am I the mind? Then he said, went deeper. Maybe I'm the intellect, because I can put things into boxes and say, these are how things are connected. So maybe I'm the intellect, buddhi. Who am I? The body? The mind? The intellect? Who am I? Who am I? He went inward and inward and inward. This is a real magic story. And I bow down to the word Kapil, the great man, not the cricketer, by the way. This is Kapil Muni, a great personality of the dharmic tradition.